So good morning and welcome back. Today we are going to discuss a very, very important topic, that is the genetics part 5. We are going to discuss the chromosomal disorders, okay? In the previous lecture we had read about the lysosomal storage disorder, and today we are going to cover all the chromosomal disorders including autosomal as well as sex chromosomal disorders. So we are going to discuss about Down syndrome, Patau syndrome, then Edwards syndrome, Klinefelter's, Turner syndrome, okay? So before we go into reading about the chromosomal disorders, first let us try to understand what is the normal karyotyping. Okay, so normal karyotype, to study the normal karyotype, we have to understand that the normal human somatic cells, okay, they are comprising 46 chromosomes in total, okay, that can be broken down into 22 pairs of autosomes and two sex chromosomes. In case of female, it is XX. In case of males, it is XY. So total, there are 46 chromosomes, 44 autosomes plus two sex chromosome. Now, karyotyping is nothing but it is the study of chromosomes under the microscope, okay? And this studying of the chromosomes under the microscope, it is called as cytogenetics, okay? Cytogenetics. Now, this can be divided into two types, okay? There is a conventional karyotyping, okay? The conventional cytogenetic study that is called as karyotyping, whereas the molecular cytogenetic study is called as FISH, okay? I repeat once again, the study of chromosomes under the microscope can be done by two ways, by conventional cytogenetics, that is called as karyotyping, and by molecular cytogenetics, that is called as FISH. So what is the karyotyping? It is the study of the number and the appearance, okay, of the chromosome inside the cell, including the abnormal chromosomes, okay? So we are trying to study the appearance as well as the abnormalities of the chromosomes inside the cell. So how do we study the chromosomes, okay? First, we need to collect certain cells, okay? So first, we collect the sample cells and we will culture it, okay? Then we will arrest the dividing cells in metaphase. So routinely, during the metaphase of the cell division, okay, we are arresting the cell in the metaphase routinely with the help of mitotic spindle inhibitors, that is N-diacetyl N-methyl colchicine, also called as colcimid, okay. Now, after the cell has been arrested during the metaphase, okay, and spread, the individual chromosome takes the form of two chromatid, which is connected at the centromere, okay, and then we have to stain the chromosome so as to observe them under the microscope. This staining is called as banding. The most commonly used stain is GMSA. That is why we call it as G banding. So here comes a very important question. What are the different types of banding? One is the G banding, where we are having an alternate light and dark bands. Light bands are those areas which are GC rich, and dark bands are those areas which are rich in the nucleotides A and T. C banding is that kind of banding which stains the centromeric region of the chromosome. Q banding is a type of banding which is stained by fluorescent dye, that is quinacridone dihydrochloride, which is visualized by fluorescent microscope. Okay, now the advantage of the Q banding is that the resolutions are far better. And there is something called as R banding. R stands for reverse banding. Okay, it is a reverse of G banding. Over here, the darker areas are rich in GC, okay, whereas the lighter areas are rich in AT. It is just opposite to the G banding. Just remember, karyotype is classically obtained by arranging each pair of the autosomes according to their decreasing length. So initially, that chromosome will be placed that is having the maximum length, that is the chromosome number 1, then 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, till 22. So till 22 autosomes, they will be arranged according to their length, and that will be followed by the last chromosome, which is the sex chromosome, XX in case of males and XY, XX in case of females, XY in case of males, okay? And then we study the spread of chromosomes under the microscope, okay? So conventional karyotyping that we do, it is having an overall resolution of 5 megabase. In routine metaphase arrest with G banding, it can detect 400 to 800 bands per haploid set of chromosome. But if the cells are obtained in prophase, so remember we had arrested the cell in the metaphase. So now, for example, if we can arrest the cell in the metaphase, in the prophase, then what will happen, that a better resolution can be obtained with as many as 1500 bands per karyotype or haploid set. So the resolution of prophase arrest is far better as compared to metaphase arrest. But remember, routinely we are making use of metaphase arrest. Okay. So what is the cytogenetic nomenclature? Okay. So first, whenever you are writing about a chromosome, how do you write? So in normal situation, we are writing 46XX or 46XY. This is the normal. First, we are writing the total number of chromosomes is given first. That is followed by the sex chromosome complement, and that is after that followed by the abnormalities in ascending numerical orders. Okay. So for example, if there is a male who is suffering from trisomy disorder 21, okay. So first we will write the total number of chromosome, because it is a trisomy of the chromosome 21. So there is an extra amount of chromosome. So instead of 46, we are having 47 chromosome followed by the sex chromosome complement, that is XY, and then the particular disorder. Here there is a trisomy of the chromosome number 21. Okay, let us see. So this is one way of classifying. Another way of classifying is like this, the numbering. How do you number it? So any one chromosome is having two arms. What is one is a short arm, that is a P arm, called as the petit arm, and then we are having a long arm called as the Q arm. First you have to write the chromosome number, then the arm, then the region, band, and then the subband. Remember, the numbering of the region, band, and subband is done from the centromere outwards. It is done from the centromere outward. So let us now see one example. For example, if they have given a chromosome XP21.2, so X is the chromosome number. So over here it is a sex chromosome, so it is X chromosome. Okay, then we have written about the arm P is indicating the arm, that is a short arm. Then the region, which is region 2, band 1, subband 2. So in your exam you might be given a particular chromosomal complement like this, and then you will have to identify it belongs to which band or which region or which subband. Now let us see the different types of chromosome depending on the position of the centromere. The first type is the telocentric variety, where the centromere is present at one end. It is not seen in human beings, and in this type no P arm is existing. It is called as telocentric variety. Then we are having the acrocentric chromosome. Here the centromere is quite away from the center, leading to a very short P arm. Okay, and the classical example is the chromosome number Y. The most important example is chromosome number Y. Other examples are also there, like chromosome 13, 14, 15, 21 and 22. All of them are acrocentric, but the most important example over here is the Y chromosome, which comes in the exam. The third type of the chromosome is submetacentric. The centromere over here is slightly away from the center, and the P arm is slightly shorter as compared to the Q arm. Again over here there are multiple examples, like chromosome number 2, 4 to 12, 17 and 18, but the most important example is chromosome number X. Okay, and lastly we are having metacentric type of chromosome. Here both the P as well as the Q arm have equal length, and the centromere over here is exactly at the center. Okay, so they are called as metacentric, and over here the number of chromosomes are chromosome 1, 3, 16, 19 and 20 are examples of metacentric chromosome. Now which is the best fixative for karyotyping? It is the Carnot's fixative, where we are using 3:1 ratio of methanol and glacial acetic acid. So what are the samples that we use for karyotyping? We can use the amniotic fluid, chorionic villi, skin fibroblast, peripheral blood lymphocytes, solid tumor samples, as well as fetal umbilical bud, which is obtained by cordocentesis. So let us see how a normal karyotype is looking like. So over here we can see that there is a spread of the chromosome. The first 22 chromosomes are the autosomes, and over here this is the classical metaphase arrest. Okay, you can see individual chromosome has divided into two chromatids, and they are joined at the centromere. Okay, so basically you can see all the chromosome, like chromosome 1 2 3 4 5 6 7, they are arranged in the decreasing order of the length, with chromosome 1 being the longest and the chromosome number 22 being the shortest. Over here we can see your 23rd chromosome, that is your XY. It is a male. Okay, so basically this is a normal male karyotype. Okay, this is the male. Yes, XY. Okay. Now we are going to start with the chromosomal abnormalities. That is the major topic for today's discussion. So the chromosomal abnormalities can be divided into two varieties. Okay, into two types. One is, there can either be an abnormality of the chromosome number. For example, total number of chromosome usually is 46. In some situation, it might be 47. In some situation, it might be 48. In some situation, it might be less. It might be 45. So it is an abnormal number of chromosome. So this is one way the chromosomal abnormalities can occur. And the other way is when there is an alteration in the structure of the chromosome. So first, let us start with the abnormalities of the chromosome number. So first, you have to understand what is the meaning of a haploid. Okay. Half the number of normal chromosome is called as haploid set or N, that is equal to 23. Okay, so haploid is equal to N is equal to 23. Any exact multiple of haploid number of chromosome, for example 2N, 3N, 4N, 5N, it is called as euploid. But if it is not a multiple of haploid, for example, it is N minus 1 or 2N minus 1 or 2N plus 1. Okay, if there is either one less chromosome or one more chromosome, if it is not an exact multiple of the haploid number, then it is called as aneuploid. Okay, aneuploid. And there are two major causes of aneuploidy. One of them is non-disjunction, another one is anaphase lag. Let us first try to understand what is non-disjunction. Non-disjunction basically refer to the chromosomes which fail to separate correctly, resulting in gametes with one extra and or one with a missing chromosome. So what happens over here during the anaphase or during the meiosis part, what happens that the chromosomes are getting separated from each other, okay, and then individual gametes are getting formed in case of meiosis, okay. But over here what happens that one of the gametes do not receive that chromosome, it receives one less chromosome, and another one receives one extra chromosome. This occurs because of non-separation of chromosomes, okay. So non-disjunction gives rise to gametes, okay, one of which is having an extra chromosome. So if that is going to fertilize a normal ovum, or for example a normal zygote will be there, so N plus 1 with N is going to give rise to 2N plus 1, and this is called as a trisomy. Okay, trisomy, because one of the gametes will be having extra chromosome. They, instead of 2, they will have 3. That is called as trisomy. In some situation, the gametes might have one less chromosome, N minus 1. So when fertilization will occur, it will give rise to a zygote having 2N minus 1. So total number of chromosome minus 1, that is going to lead to monosomy. Okay, monosomy. Okay, so let us first try and understand the mechanism of non-disjunction. So non-disjunction, before we understand the process of non-disjunction, we first have to understand the normal meiotic division. So this is a normal cell which is undergoing meiotic division. If you all remember, meiotic division is a reduction division. Okay, reduction division. So in the meiosis one, that is also called as anaphase one, see how the chromosomes are getting separated. And once the chromosomes are separated, they are divided. Okay, and then there is a further division such that the individual gametes are getting N, or a haploid set of chromosomes. Okay, this is what is happening normally. In case of non-disjunction, which is occurring in the meiosis, as you can compare with the normal, the amount of chromosomes, they are not segregated properly such that one of the cells is receiving less amount of chromosome and another cell is receiving extra amount of chromosome, and ultimately we are having two population of gametes. One of them, half of the gametes are having one extra, N plus 1, whereas our other half is having one less, N minus 1. So this is one of the causes of non-disjunction in meiosis 1. Now non-disjunction can also occur in meiosis 2. Suppose this is a normal cell, meiosis 1 has occurred normally, but in the case of meiosis 2, the separation did not take place properly such that half of the gametes are having normal, whereas the other half is having abnormal number of chromosomes like N plus 1 and N minus 1. So non-disjunction is one of the very important causes of aneuploidy. Okay, this is the first mechanism, that is non-disjunction. The second mechanism of aneuploidy is anaphase lag. Okay, over here what is happening, that one homologous chromosome in meiosis or one chromatid in mitosis, they lag behind, resulting in one normal cell, whereas other cell is there which is having monosomy. Okay, one cell with monosomy. So what is happening over here, let's try to understand. So this is the phase of meiosis. Okay, this is the phase of meiosis where during the anaphase, during the separation of the chromatid, one of the chromosome lags behind and they are not going towards the poles. Okay, as a result, one set of chromosome is destroyed. So when there is a cell division, okay, when there is a cell division, one of these sets, okay, one set of chromosomes, okay, if you will see, they will have one less amount of chromosome because of destruction of the chromosome which was left behind. So they will be having n minus one, whereas another set will have the normal haploid set. So this is this is the basic cause of aneuploidy, whether it be non-disjunction or whether it be anaphase lag. In any situation, either we are having one extra chromosome or we are having one less, and they are not an exact multiple of n. So we are having aneuploidy. Hope you have understood these mechanisms. Okay. So remember, monosomy or trisomy, when it is involving the sex chromosome, they are compatible with life, okay? But remember, monosomy, when they involve the autosomes, they cause too much loss of genetic information to permit live birth. So they are not well tolerated, okay? They are not well tolerated. Trisomies, remember one thing, even the trisomies which are involving the autosomes, okay, they are also not permitting survival. Just remember, with the exception of Down syndrome, that is trisomy 21, all other trisomies of the autosomes are very severe and there is a death very early in the life. I will repeat this point once again. Remember, monosomy and trisomy of the sex chromosomes are compatible with life, but the same is not true for monosomy and trisomy of the autosomes. Okay, remember, monosomy involving the autosomes are not compatible with life, whereas trisomies involving the autosomes are also not compatible with life, with the exception of Down syndrome or trisomy 21, which permits the survival of life into adulthood. Okay, so remember, sometimes mitotic errors might occur in the early development, which gives rise to two or more population of cells with different chromosome complement in the same individual. What I want to say, for example, any one individual, for example, a normal male, all of the cells in case of a normal male will have 46XY. All the cells will have 46XY only. So they are having one kind of chromosome only. But sometimes what happens, because of mitotic errors in the early stage of embryogenesis, what will happen is that instead of having a single population of cells, for example 46XY, they are having 46XXY and 46XY. So they are having two different kinds of chromosomal makeup in the same individual. This is called as mosaicism. So mosaicism, if it involves the autosomes, autosomal mosaicism is far less common and they are not compatible with life. Whereas mosaicism can also affect the sex chromosome. Example, during division of a fertilized ovum, there is a mitotic error. So one daughter cell is receiving one sex chromosome, whereas other is receiving three sex chromosomes. So the basically all the cells in that particular cell will be, one of the zygotes will be 45X, whereas another of the zygote will be 47XXX. So as a result, you will have two population of cell in the same individual. One of them will be having 45X as the total number of chromosome, and another one will be having 47XXX as the total number of chromosome in the same individual. This is the mosaic variant of Turner syndrome. So this is all about mosaicism. Okay, now first we are going to read about the alterations in the chromosomal structure. So we have read about the alterations in the chromosomal number. Now we will see the alterations in the chromosomal structure. Remember, to detect the structural changes by conventional karyotyping, that is banding, it requires a very large amount of DNA. Approximately 2 to 4 million base pairs of DNA is required to detect any kind of structural alteration by conventional karyotyping. Therefore, to detect the structural abnormalities with ease and with higher resolution, we are going for molecular cytogenetics. Okay, molecular karyotyping is done, that is FISH. It can detect changes as small as kilobytes. Okay, as small as kilobytes. So let us see the different types of alterations in the structure. Sometimes we can have deletion. Deletion means a portion of the chromosome, usually the interstitial portion, is deleted. Okay, is deleted from the chromosome. This is called as deletion. Second is the formation of a ring chromosome. It is a special form of deletion where breaks occur at both the ends of the chromosome, as you can see, with the fusion of the damaged ends, which gives rise to a ring chromosome. Okay, remember, if sufficient material is lost, then it can lead to phenotypical abnormality, and ring chromosomal abnormality is written as 46XYR14, means it is involving chromosome number 14. Okay, chromosome number 14 is ring chromosome. Okay, this is represented like this. then we are having inversion. It refers to rearrangement that involves two breaks within a single chromosome with reincorporation of the inverted intervening segment. So what is happening over here? It is of two types. So when the inversion or the exchange of the chromosomal material is taking place in a single arm, it is called as paracentric inversion, that is involving one arm. What is happening over here? That see, I have marked one in black. So the information which was present in black, okay, it goes to the area which was present in the red. Okay, so whatever information was present in the black portion goes to red, and whatever was present in red goes to black. This is called as inversion. Since they are involving a single arm of the chromosome, it is called as paracentric inversion. Okay, similarly we are having pericentric inversion, when the exchange of the genetic material between the two parts is involving the opposite arms, it is called as pericentric. Often inversion is often fully compatible with normal development. Then we are having isochromosome. So remember, here the chromosome divides in an axis perpendicular to the usual axis of division. Remember, normally a cell divides vertically. This is the normal axis of division. Okay, but in this case of isochromosome, there is a horizontal division that leads to formation of two chromosomes, one having two short arms, one having two long arms. Okay, this is abnormal. Usually you have to remember, one arm is short and one arm is long in one chromosome, but over here we are having chromosome, each chromosome either is having two short arm or is having two long arm, which is not normal. So isochromosome, they are having morphologically identical genetic information in both the arms. Okay, the most common isochromosome in human being is XQ, which is involving the long arm of X, whereas the most common isochromosome associated with neoplasia is 17q chromosome. Okay, 17q chromosome is involved. Okay, now number fifth type of alteration in the chromosomal structure is translocation, where what happens that a segment of the chromosome is transferred to another part. Okay, so when equal amount of chromosome is transferred to the other region, okay, when the exchange of the chromosomal material between the two chromosome is there with no net gain or loss of genetic material, it is called as balanced translocation. If you can see in this diagram, equal amount of information is being exchanged between the two chromosomes, okay, and there is no net loss of genetic material over here. This is called as balanced reciprocal translocation. Another type is called as Robertsonian translocation, where the exchange of material is not equal. Okay, so it is basically Robertsonian translocation is involving the acrocentric chromosome, and over here once this is there, it results in two types of chromosome. One is abnormally large and one chromosome is extremely small. So this extremely small chromosome is not compatible, or it is completely lost. Okay, means this small amount of chromosome, it is not valid and it is lost in the process. But because very less amount of genetic material is lost, okay, this loss is compatible with normal life. Okay, remember the frequency of Robertsonian translocation is 1 in 1,000, apparently normal individual, and the significance is that it is seen in few cases of Down syndrome. I will just explain you, when the exchange of information between the two chromosome, when it is taking place, which is it is not equally taking place, it results in Robertsonian translocation. What happens that these two acrocentric chromosomes, okay, they are exchanging material in such a way that one of the chromosomes is becoming abnormally large, whereas another one is becoming extremely small and is getting lost. But this amount of chromosome that is getting lost is compatible with normal life. Okay, it is not that much significant. Now we are going to discuss the chromosomal abnormalities which are involving the autosomes. Okay, number one is the Down syndrome. You all know Down syndrome is nothing but trisomy of the chromosome autosome 21. So this is the karyotype and this is the trisomy. The 21st chromosome, instead of having two chromosomes, is having three. That is why we are calling the term trisomy over here. So let us first try to understand, okay, the cytogenetic disorders involving the autosomes. The first one is the trisomy 21, that is the Down syndrome. Now most common, it is the most common of the chromosomal disorders, and it is the major cause of intellectual disability. It is the most common genetic cause of mental retardation. It is the most common type of autosomal trisomy that survives till birth, but the most common trisomy in human beings in general is trisomy 16. What is the molecular basis of Down syndrome? Now, as we have already discussed about the non-disjunction. Okay, so these are lying at the heart of Down syndrome. The first mechanism of Down syndrome is the meiotic non-disjunction. It is the maternal non-disjunction. Non-disjunction that is taking place in the ovum, in the mother. It is the most common cause of trisomy or Down syndrome. Parents are normal in all respect. The maternal age has a strong influence on the incidence of trisomy 21. So more is the maternal age, more is the risk of suffering from Down syndrome. Remember, meiotic non-disjunction is mostly occurring at the level of the ovum, and 95% of the cases of trisomy 21, it is of maternal origin. Meiotic non-disjunction is occurring in meiosis 1. Remember, meiotic non-disjunction over here takes place at meiosis 1. Remember, all trisomies except the trisomy number 80, remember, the meiotic non-disjunction is occurring in meiosis 1. In trisomy 18, meiotic non-disjunction is occurring in meiosis 2. So in all the trisomies that we are going to read, the non-disjunction is affecting meiosis 1. Only in case of Edwards syndrome or trisomy 18, that the meiotic non-disjunction is affecting the meiosis too. The second mechanism of Down syndrome, molecular mechanism, is Robertsonian translocation, as I already explained. It is accounting for 4% cases of Down syndrome, and over here the extra chromosomal material is deriving from the presence of Robertsonian translocation of the long arm of the chromosome 21 to another acrocentric chromosome, that is 14 or 22. So again over here there is an exchange of material leading to one very large and one very small. Okay, so the excess amount of information is there over here because of the Robertsonian translocation, and the translocation is occurring from the long arm of the chromosome 21 to another acrocentric chromosome. Mostly these cases are familial, and the translocated chromosome inherited from one of the parent, usually the mother, who is a carrier of Robertsonian translocation. Okay, now the third important mechanism of Down syndrome is mosaicism. It accounts for 1% cases of the Down syndrome, and it occurs due to mitotic non-disjunction of the chromosome 21 during early embryogenesis. Remember, I am using the term mitotic non-disjunction. Remember, whenever there is a mitotic non-disjunction, okay, it will lead to mosaicism. All changes will take place somatically within the same individual. So there will be two population of cell. There is a mixture of cells. A few of the cells in the individual will have 46 chromosome, that is the normal amount of chromosome, and few of them will have 47 chromosomes, okay, an extra amount of chromosome. So there will be two population of cell, one having trisomy 21, one having normal number of chromosomes. So they are mosaic. Again over here, maternal age has no significance. So remember, maternal age has no significance in case of Robertsonian translocation and in case of mosaicism, but they are of significance in case of meiotic non-disjunction. Okay, so the clinical feature of a patient of Down syndrome, basically they are having a flat facial profile with oblique palpable fissures, and they are having epicanthic folds. Down syndrome, as we discussed, it is a leading cause of severe mental retardation, and approximately 80% of the those affected with Down syndrome, they are having an IQ of 25 to 50. Remember one thing, that mosaics are having a normal or near normal intelligence. What is the reason behind this? Because they are having a population of cell. Okay, they are having two population of cell. They are having one normal population with one trisomy population. Therefore, they are having normal or near normal intelligence. The cardiac clinical features of Down syndrome, approximately 40% of Down syndrome patients have congenital heart disease. The most common congenital heart disease is atrioventricular septal defects, that is the endocardial cushion defects, affecting 43% of the cases. Ventricular septal defects affecting 32% of the cases. Atrial septal defects affecting 9% of the cases, and tetralogy of Fallot affecting 6% of the cases. Most of the deaths in infancy and early childhood, it occurs because of cardiac problems, because of cardiac problem. Now, leukemias in case of Down syndrome. Children with Down syndrome, they are having a very high risk of development of leukemia. They have 20 times increased risk of ALL, that is acute lymphoblastic leukemia of B cell type, and they have a 500-fold increased risk of acute myeloid leukemia, most commonly of AML M7 type, that is acute megakaryoblastic type. It develops in the first 3 years of life, and they have GATA1 mutation as well. So remember, the most common type of AML that occurs in Down syndrome is AML M7 or acute megakaryoblastic variety. Also remember, it is developing in the first 3 years of life, and they have one mutation called as the GATA1 mutation. Also remember that 10% of newborns with Down syndrome, they also have a condition called as transient abnormal myelopoiesis. It is spontaneously resolving in the first 3 months of life, but around 20-30% of the cases eventually develop AML within the first 4 years of life. In the GIT, there is esophageal atresia or small bowel atresia. Virtually all patients of Down syndrome of more than 40 years, they develop Alzheimer's disease, and they also have an abnormal immune response leading to recurrent infections of the lung along with thyroid autoimmunity. Now the median age of death in case of Down syndrome is around 47 years. Okay, so as we see that the trisomy involving the chromosome number 21, that is the Down syndrome, it is surviving into adulthood, unlike the other trisomies which are affecting the autosomes. Okay. Now, other clinical features of Downs is the development of simian crease, abundant neck skin, umbilical hernia, hypotonia, and gap between the first and second toe. So let us see this particular diagram. You can see they are having a flat facial profile. See, they are having a tilted oblique palpable fissure. They are having a lot of epicanthic fold. Even the iris is showing classical brush field spots on the iris. They are having single palmar crease. If you can see, they are having a single palmar crease. There is a wide gap between the first and the second toes. They have small hypoplastic ears with fissured tongues in adults. Okay. Yes. So this is all about the Down syndrome. Okay. Now we will read about another trisomy of the autosome, that is the Edwards syndrome, which is the trisomy of the chromosome number 18. Okay, the incidence of this case is 1 in 8,000 birth. The karyotype is they are trisomy 18, presented as 47XX plus 18, or they can be having a mosaic type as well with 46XX along with 47XX plus 18. So clinically, they are having prominent occiput with micrognathia, means small jaws. Intellectual disability is there with low set ears, short neck, overlapping fingers, congenital heart defects, renal malformation, limited hip abduction, and they are having a classical rocker bottom feet. Let us see the features over here in this diagram. So we can see they are having micrognathia with a small mouth, small jaw, short neck. They are having a shield chest, okay, short prominent sternum is there and widely set nipples. They have prominent occiput as we saw, okay, dysplastic malformed ears, and very importantly, they are having clenched hands with overlapping fingers, and they have flexed big toe with prominent heels like a rocker bottom feet, okay, rocker bottom feet. Now, the other trisomy that we are going to discuss is the Patau syndrome. So this Patau syndrome, if we see, it is the trisomy of the chromosome number 13. The incidence is 1 in 15,000 birth. Around they are having three types of karyotypes. Some of them may have just trisomy 13, 47XX plus 13. Translocation type might be there, which is having 46XX translocation 13, 14. And there can be a mosaic type, which is having two different population of cell. One of the cells having the normal karyotype like 46XX, whereas the other is having a trisomy 13 karyotype. Okay. Now, what are the clinical features of the patient, the Patau syndrome? They are having microphthalmia, microcephaly, mental retardation, cleft lip, cleft palate, polydactyly, cardiac or renal defects with umbilical hernia, and again they are having rocker bottom feet. Let us see this diagram. So classically, the most important point is they are having a small head, but along with that, if you see, they are having an absent eyebrow and classically cleft lip and or cleft palate might be there. Okay. Again, they are having dysplastic deformed ears, clenched hands, and polydactyly is quite common with undescended or abnormal testis. Okay. So how is the Down syndrome different from the other trisomies like the Patau and Edwards? So remember, like the Down syndrome, both Patau and Edwards is having one complete extra copy of chromosome 13 or 18. Okay, and all these three are associated with increased maternal age. But remember, compared to Down syndrome, as I already said before, Patau and Edwards syndrome, they have malformations which are much more severe and wide ranging, and as a result, they only rarely do infants survive beyond first year of life. So any kind of trisomy of the autosome, they do not survive long except Down syndrome. Okay. Now, one other abnormality involving the autosome is chromosome 22q11.2 deletion syndrome. So it's a spectrum of disorder occurring because of a small deletion of the band q11.2 on the long arm of chromosome 22, affecting 1 in 4,000 births. Clinically, the patient presents with congenital heart disease, abnormalities of the palate, facial dysmorphism, developmental delay, variable degrees of T-cell immunodeficiency, as well as hypocalcemia. So previously, this disorder was represented by two different syndromes. One of them was Diogenes, another one was velocardial facial defect. So Diogenes syndrome was classically characterized by thymic hypoplasia with T-cell immunodeficiency, parathyroid hypoplasia, it is not hyper, it is hypoplasia, leading to hypocalcemia, cardiac abnormalities affecting the outflow tract, and mild facial abnormality. The other syndrome was the velocardial facial defect, which was characterized by facial dysmorphism, abnormal facies, prominent nose, retrognathia, cleft palate, cardiovascular anomalies, learning disability, and they might also have immunodeficiencies. Until recently, the overlapping clinical features of these two conditions were not appreciated. Only after it was known that both the syndromes are having the same cytogenetic abnormality that the overlap came into the picture. So both these are now considered as a single anomaly, that is the chromosome 22q11.2 deletion syndrome. Individuals with 22q11.2 deletion syndrome are at a higher risk of psychotic illness such as schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. Okay, and remember, this develops in around 25% of the adults with this syndrome. Remember, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is present in 30 to 35% of the affected children. The diagnosis of this condition is made by Fish, and the molecular basis of this syndrome is a TBX1 transcription factor, which is targeting PAX9 gene. It is a gene which is involvement, which is important for the development of the palate, thymus, and parathyroid. So if this particular gene is involved, okay, they will have cleft palate, abnormal facies, they will have hypoplasia of the thymus leading to immunodeficiencies, hypoplasia of the parathyroid leading to hypocalcemia. So this is how a person looks like. They are having a dysmorphic facies, a case of a 22q11.2 deletion syndrome. So now we are going to start with the chromosomal abnormalities which are involving the sex chromosome. Let us see them. So cytogenetic disorders involving the sex chromosome. So sex chromosomal disorders are much more common than the autosomal disorders, and they are much better tolerated than the autosomal disorders. So what is the reason behind that? One reason is there is a lionization or inactivation of one X chromosome. So one thing that we have to understand, because there is a concept of lionization. What is lionization? It is the random inactivation of one X chromosome. It happens normally in all the females, okay? It is represented by the bar body, okay? So what happens if there is any abnormalities in that particular X chromosome, that is going to get inactivated because of lionization. So that abnormality will not be expressed. Second is, very less amount of genetic material is carried by the Y chromosome. So even if the Y chromosome is involved, there is not much phenotypic abnormality occurring. Okay. So what is the Lyons hypothesis? So Lyons hypothesis discusses about the random X chromosome inactivation. Remember, females are having two X chromosomes, remember, okay? And one of them, they are randomly inactivated, okay? So only one of the X chromosome in case of a female is genetically active. The other X chromosome is either of maternal or paternal origin is rendered inactive. Now, inactivation of either the maternal or paternal X occurs at random, and it occurs very early in the life of the patient. Okay, is around day 5.5 of the embryonic life, of the fetal life. Okay, inactivation of the same X chromosome persists in all the cells derived from each precursor cell. So whatever cell is derived from that, okay, so inactivation of the same X is going to persist in all the cells which are derived from each precursor cell. Therefore, remember, normal females, they are like mosaic. They are having two different population of cells. One which is having inactivated maternal X and other which is having inactivated paternal X. So either of the two, either of the X chromosome might get inactivated. Okay. So one population of cell may have, inactivated maternal X. Another population may have inactivated paternal X. So there are two populations. So therefore, in the true sense, normal females are mosaic. Now, remember, the inactive X chromosome can be seen in the interface nucleus as a darkly staining small mass in contact with the nuclear membrane, which is called as the bar body. Remember, the molecular basis of X chromosome inactivation is unique, and it is involving a gene called as the ZIST gene, which is a long non-coding RNA involved in gene silencing.
Okay, so let us see how to calculate the number of bar bodies. Remember, number of bar bodies is equal to n minus 1, where n is the number of X chromosome. So in case of a normal male, there is only one X. So 1 minus 1 is equal to 0. So the total number of bar bodies in a normal male is 0. Whereas in a normal female, they are having two X chromosomes. So it is 2 minus 1, that is equal to 1. Okay, so normal female is having one bar body. In case of Turner syndrome, that is 45XO, there is single X. So 1 minus 1, it becomes 0. In case of Klinefelter syndrome, it is 2 minus 1 becoming 1. Okay, so remember, one thing we have to understand, when I am saying that there is an inactivation of an X chromosome, we have to remember one important fact, that not all the regions of that X chromosome is inactivated. Some of the genes are working. Around 21% of the genes in the inactivated X chromosome, that is in the short arm of X, and around 3% of genes in the long arm of the inactivated X, they escape inactivation. So when I am saying one of the X chromosome is inactivated, remember, not the entire X chromosome is inactivated, okay? Some portions of the X chromosome that is inactivated is still active, okay? Remember, the Y chromosome has two regions. One is the SRY gene, okay, which is the sex determining region of the Y gene, which is present in the short arm of Y chromosome, or the P. It is present in the distal part of the Y chromosome. It is important for testicular development, whereas the MSY, or the male specific Y region, is encoding 75 proteins, and it is testis specific and involved in spermatogenesis. Now we will discuss certain common features of all sex chromosomal disorder. Remember, in general, sex chromosomal disorder, they cause very mild, subtle problems relating to sexual development and fertility, okay? The sex chromosomal disorders are often very difficult to diagnose at birth, and they are mainly recognized at puberty. Okay, in general, remember, greater the number of X chromosome in both males and females, greater is the likelihood of mental retardation. Now, the two most important disorders which are arising because of abnormalities of the sex chromosomes are Klinefelter syndrome and Turner syndrome. Let us now discuss each one of them. Number one is the Klinefelter syndrome. So Klinefelter syndrome is best defined as male hypogonadism. So it is a male who is having underdeveloped testis when there are two or more X chromosome and one or more Y chromosome. It is the most common cause of hypogonadism in case of males, and the incidence is 1 in 660 live male births. The karyotype is 47XXY, which is the most common karyotype seen in 90% of the cases, and most commonly it occurs due to meiotic non-disjunction in either the mother or the father. The second important cause of this karyotype is the mosaicism. In 50% of the cases, they can have 46XY along with 47XXY or 47XXY along with 48XXY. Clinically, these patients are having elongated body with abnormally long eggs called as eucnoid body habitus. They are having male infertility. And remember, Klinefelter syndrome is the most common cause of male sterility with minimal or no mental retardation. There is a lack of secondary male sexual characteristic, small atrophic testis with small penis. They are having gynecomastia, which is present, and this gynecomastia is present with 20-fold increased risk of breast carcinoma. Now, all these abnormalities occurs because of excessive amount of FSH and estrogen and reduced amount of testosterone. Also, these patients are having an increased incidence of type 2 diabetes mellitus as well as metabolic syndrome due to increased insulin resistance. The most common cardiac anomaly in such patients is the mitral valve prolapse seen in 50% of the adults of Klinefelter syndrome. And there is also an increased incidence of fractures and osteoporosis because of sex hormone imbalance. Microscopically, we can see atrophied testicular tubules with prominent Leydig cells. The next important sex chromosomal disorder and the last one is the Turner syndrome. Turner syndrome is resulting from complete or partial monosomy of the X chromosome, and it's characterized by hypogonadism in phenotypic females. It is the most common sex chromosome abnormality in females. Now, this is an important long question that comes, the karyotypic abnormalities of the Turner syndrome. 57% of the cases are missing an entire X chromosome, so they have the karyotype 45X, which is the most common karyotype. 14% of the cases are having structural abnormalities of the X chromosome, isochromosome of long arm resulting in loss of the short arm, ring chromosome formation, as well as deletion of portions of short or long arm. And 29% cases are more mosaic. That is, they are having two distinct cell population, like 45X, 46XX, 45X, 46XY, 45X, 47XXX, 45X, 46XI. That is isochromosome. So there can be combination of cells as well. So 5 to 10% of Turner syndrome patients have complete Y chromosome, or they are having fragments of Y chromosome translocated on other chromosome. Such cases, they are having a very high risk for development of gonadoblastoma. Okay. So what is happening? They are having either complete Y chromosome, okay, is translocated to other chromosome. So 5 to 10% of Turner syndrome patients, they are having complete Y chromosome, or they are having certain portions of the Y chromosome translocated to the X chromosome. So these patients who are having extra amount of Y chromosomal material, they are having an increased risk for development of gonadoblastoma. Most severely affected patient presents during infancy with edema of the dorsum of the hands and foot because of lymphatic stasis. Sometimes there is a stasis around the nape of the neck leading to swelling, and it occurs because of markedly distended lymph channels producing cystic hygroma. The swelling in the nape of the neck subsides, but the looseness of the skin on back of the neck will persist. That leads to the characteristic bilateral neck webbing. Now, congenital heart defects is affecting around 25 to 50% of the patient, with the most common defect being a bicuspid aortic valve followed by a preductal coarctation of aorta. CVS anomalies are the most important cause of increased mortality, and the ovaries are completely fibrotic. Severely fibrotic and atrophic ovaries, called as streak ovaries, are there, which leads to infertility and amenorrhea. Patients are having short stature with amenorrhea. Remember, Turner syndrome is the single most important cause of primary amenorrhea, accounting for 1/3 of the cases. These cases are having low posterior hairline, webbing of the neck, broad chest with widely spaced nipples, and having a normal breast histology. They have cubitus valgus, failure to develop normal secondary sexual characteristic, pigmented nevus. They are having a normal mental status and autoantibody against the thyroid, leading to hypothyroidism. Okay, majority of the patients, they develop glucose intolerance and diabetes with obesity and insulin resistance. Remember, the short stature of the patients of Turner syndrome is because of loss of both copies of the SHOX gene on the X chromosome. That is the short stature homeobox gene. Now, this gene is also present in the Y chromosome. 75% cases of the X chromosome is maternal in origin, suggesting that there is an abnormality in the paternal gametogenesis. Okay. So with this, we have ended the chromosomal disorders. So those students who are interested to get the notes and the PDFs and the MCQs, you can join my online pathology batch, which is held every Saturday and Sunday at 8 p.m. and 9 a.m. Indian Standard Time. Platform is online, Zoom app. And thank you very much, guys, for providing the support towards this channel. You can contribute via the PayPal links given in the description box, www.paypal.me/simplypathology. And if you like the content, please do not forget to share this with your friends and in those with need. Thank you very much, guys.